हेलो।
या मंगल पर्थ, वी कैन हियर यू, बट ऑफ एन एको देयर।
बट ऑफ एन एको देयर।
यू वी लॉस्ट यू।
वी
लॉस्ट
लॉस्ट
यू।
यू।
फाइन सर, इज इट
फाइन सर, इज इट
हेलो।
हेलो।
हेलो, आर यू ऑनलाइन?
हेलो, ऑनलाइन?
या मंगल पार्टी, वी
या
कैन
मंगल
हियर यू, बट
पार्टी, वी
स्टिल
कैन हियर
बिट
यू,
ऑफ
बट
इको।
स्टिल बिट इको।
या आई एम ऑल्सो वंडरिंग वेयर इट इज
या आई
कमिंग
एम ऑल्सो
फ्रॉम।
वंडरिंग वेयर इट इज कमिंग फ्रॉम। आई
आई एम गेटिंग ए रेगुलर इको ऑफ व्हाट एवर आई
एम
एम
गेटिंग ए
स्पीकिंग।
रेगुलर इको ऑफ व्हाट एवर आई एम स्पीकिंग। व्हाट एवर आई एम स्पीकिंग।
सर, कैन यू
व्हाट
रिमूव
एवर आई
योर
एम स्पीकिंग।
हेडफोन एंड ट्राई?
सर, कैन यू रिमूव योर हेडफोन एंड ट्राई?
Just I'll try to connect to the app. Just give me 1 minute. At the outset, my sincere thanks and regards to NNF Karnataka OHM Hospital for taking this initiative, and Pradeep sir for the kind and nice introduction, and Abhishek for wonderfully organizing such a good teaching program, especially in these difficult times. So I think I understand that this is part of a series of lectures that are been happening on neonatal ventilation. So I'm sure that most of the participants will have a very good idea about the basics of ventilation right now. So as you have already finished the many important lectures, and also I think I'm pretty sure that ventilator is a machine that we neonatologists, especially people who are working in NICU, are very fond of to play around with. And this is something like our favorite toy. And so we are I'm not sure whether we are what to say, we the right kind of skills and the right technique of playing around with the ventilator, every one of us. But I think to a reasonable extent, most of us seem to be quite comfortable whenever we make a change to a ventilator. We are not afraid of this machine anymore. So why this talk? So just to, I think, just for a change and to keep people occupied in an afternoon time, 1 to 2. Difficult time to have a lecture, so I thought so many online series are going on every day. We are getting bombarded with webinars, so lots and lots of PowerPoints are there. So I thought I'll just make use of a board simply, so that we can remain more focused. And senior people here, first like to make a disclaimer, my sincere apologies. And this lecture will be focusing more on the very basics of pulmonary graphics, and my focus will be in making sure people understand the very basics of pulmonary, and so that they start making use of. There are enough gadgets, lots of machineries and investigations already there in our NICU, especially when we put a baby on the ventilator. These pulmonary graphics doesn't seem to be available in each and every ventilator, especially in units where people have lots of old generation ventilators. So this option is a fancy option, and looks like it's there by default by most of the new ventilators. And even the old ventilators are getting upgraded whenever people want to have a display which shows some graphs. Well, definitive treatment. So most of the times, so we bring in measures to combat the primary problem. But till they work, until the lungs get better, so we need the baby to hold on. So we know the neonates have got very, very poor resource. So they can't breathe on their own till the pathology settles down to a reasonable extent. So support, in the, especially in the form of a mechanical ventilation, is very, very crucial in saving the lives of many, many small and sick neonates. Having said that, I think we keep on hearing a lot about this terminology, you know, so ventilator induced lung injury. So whether you like it or not, I think those timings where we saw lots and lots of big babies on the ventilator are gone nowadays, no? We hardly see one or two babies even in busy units where many babies are being taken care. Most of the babies who undergo ventilation right now are these preterm babies with very, very immature lungs. Even the lungs of the term babies can get affected by the forces of a ventilation. So I think the primary reason everyone will understand, the simple, most and basic reason why we are very much worried is in, so we are using a positive pressure ventilation. This is not in line with nature. So the natural way of breathing is a negative pressure breathing. So in simple terms, we are all sucking air into our lungs. So we are pulling air. Nobody is pushing air into our lungs. So the human lungs are designed only to suck air into their lungs by creating a negative pressure in the pleura, whereas the outside pressure remains constant. But what happens in mechanical ventilation is that we are creating a positive pressure, that means a pressure higher than the atmospheric pressure which is there in the lungs, so that we are pushing air into the lungs. So this, but this seems to be the best way where we can ensure a proper delivery of the pressure, volume and flow. We are not able to create a design or a system of a stubborn or a good system of negative pressure ventilation is not possible. So the whatever be the age, whether it is an adult, pediatrics, or in neonates, so the norm universally is a positive pressure ventilation. But the lungs of a preterm and small neonate is very, very prone for injury because of the exposure to this positive pressures. So we know, I'm not going to discuss in detail the various ways in which the lungs can get injured, but all that we know is that whatever we use, whether it is a pressure, if you give pressure, pressure can damage more pressure, and if you give more volume, so then what is required, maybe can develop volume trauma. Just simply the flow, if it is quite high, so we are not using the presence of an endotracheal tube there, so we know various terminologies, rheotrauma, biotraumas, and many things. So what is the biggest challenge whenever we put a baby on a ventilator? So we know as much as possible, we try to make use of non-invasive ventilation. That means trying to not put the baby on a ventilator. That's the first and foremost thing to save the lungs of the baby. But that depends on a given situation. So how sick the baby is and how severely affected are the lungs of this baby. So in case this non-invasive will work well for mild to moderate kind of lung disease, but there are babies who might have moderate to severe disease, or babies who are may not have a good ability to breathe. So whenever the central nervous system gets affected, when their respiratory drive is poor, or babies who are having a hemodynamic instability. So there are many reasons why we may have to bring in invasive ventilation. The invasive ventilation is more powerful, gives an fantastic support to the baby till the baby recovers. So the moment we decide to put a baby on an invasive ventilation, so the challenge is that on one hand, we know that, okay, this is a very crucial tool. We need to make use of this tool. On the other hand, we know that, okay, this tool can damage the lungs of the baby, and the repercussions are not going to be only in short term. They may last for a very long term also. This increases the chances of the baby developing lots of secretions, lots of microatelectasis cases, damage to the lungs results in poor alveolization, can increase the resistance, the airways can become very thick, the pulmonary pressures can go up. So all we know that what we mean by bronchopulmonary dysplasia or a chronic lung disease, they can have problems later if we allow the baby to suffer ventilator-induced lung injury. So the challenge or the main focus whenever we put a baby on a ventilator is we need to So this is the biggest challenge, I think, before everyone who is taking care of a newborn baby who has been put on a ventilator. Okay. So we play around with various settings, and it is not, despite ventilation being in practice for so many decades, no one can tell you that, so however experience that individual has, he or she, they can't tell you which is the right kind of pressure, the right kind of volume, or the right kind of flow that we should be using for the given baby. So every baby is different, and the situation is very dynamic. The situations keep changing over a period of time very frequently, as the lung, either the lung might become sick or more worse, or the baby may recover. So we need to keep on making changes to the ventilator so that we optimize this mechanical ventilation with the needs of the baby. So optimization in terms of what? Whenever we say optimization, what are the various things that we try to optimize? So number one, I think this is where you all will know what we mean by synchronization. No. So we are not facing a situation where the baby is totally knocked out and only the ventilator is going to totally take care of the baby. Baby is also breathing, and so there is a high possibility, and we can take it for granted that definitely when we just put a baby on a support, the machine and the baby may not breathe in a synchronous way. So we try to match the support to the every component of respiration of a baby. So when the baby starts taking a breath, how long the baby holds the breath, when the baby moves into expiration, and how long the baby remains in expiration, and how much support the baby requires in these various components of inspiration. This is what we mean by synchrony. And I think there are lots and lots of modes of ventilation, you will know. So we know the basic modes, SAMV and assist control, which we use day in and day out. Beyond SAMV and assist control, we know that lots and lots of modes have come in. We have pressure support ventilation. We have volume guarantee and various other PRVC, which are mimics or almost the equivalents of these hybrid modes of ventilation where a volume guarantee is brought. So we need to optimize synchronization. Okay, that's one. What are the other things, very important things to me when synchronization, if I think about optimization? Most importantly, we are just dealing with these three things. No? We are delivering some pressure. So what are the pressures? We deliver two kinds of pressures. So PAP during inspiration and PWP during expiration. So pressure can damage the lungs a lot. So for every baby, we need to use the optimal PWP and an optimal PAP. So this word is, I may be repeating this word throughout this lecture. So optimal, optimal, optimal. Because that's the magic word in ventilation. How do we optimize it? So because it's a very, very thin line. It's a narrow window. And if you're using lesser pressures are not safe. So on both sides, the lung gets injured. If you're not using the adequate pressures, or if you're giving higher pressures, so you just, we all know the safe zone, no? You know the curve of ventilation. There is a call, there is a, we have to always operate in the safe zone, either go down nor move up. Okay, so how can we optimize these pressures whenever a baby is on a ventilator? That is very important. And obviously, another main thing that needs to be optimized is, okay, volume. But most of us, even though some hybrid modes of ventilation have found a place and have moved into most of our units, we are not primarily using volume-based modes. In the pediatric intensive care unit and in the adults, they are primarily using volume-controlled ventilation. So where the primarily the tidal volume is set. We know the tidal volume, no? Because just give, okay, 5 ml per kg. So if it is a 2 kg baby, set a tidal volume of 10 ml. Let the ventilator decide what is the pressure required. So the biggest advantage will be an automatic change in pressures. Whenever the lung compliance improves, the pressure machine will automatically bring down the pressures. The lung compliance worsens, the machine will give more pressures. So that's quite convenient, but we are dealing with very, very small newborn babies. Sometimes babies who are, especially those ELBW babies, and even the technology is improving now with the microprocessors getting better every day. So now there is a provision of volume controlled ventilation for neonates as well. But I think most of you will agree, right now we are in a phase where we are doing pressure-based ventilation, which we are comfortable in doing for a long time. We all know the phrase that known devils are always better than unknown angels. We have been using this for a long, long time. So we have settled for adding a volume guarantee to this pressure-based ventilation. And hardly I am aware of units who are primarily using volume control modes for ventilating units, but that may come up in future. So the volume is something which we don't operate directly, but we look into. Okay, we always play around with pressures, but the target is always the volume. Why am I delivering the right volume? Delivering more or less volume, that's going to be fine. So we need to optimize the volume that is being delivered. And we have some settings for time. This is very crucial. So we have, we set the respiratory rate in a ventilator. How much rate we do we set? And we set a time for inspiration, TI. We set a time for expiration, TE. Okay, so what is the, you may start with some arbitrary number for all these three based upon the size of the baby and given clinical condition, but we may need to work on it. It may not, the initial numbers, so what we thought will be the right ones, may not be the right ones in many cases. So we may have to work on either coming down or going up on the respiratory rate set on the ventilator. And we may have to play around this TA and TE in certain situations. Okay? And of course, the other setting what we change is in flow. Okay. So most of the reason ventilators have got good intelligence. They can choose the flow on their own. But there are some ventilators where you may have to set a flow. So, but we need to realize certain situations where the set flow may be less or more. Let's also, that we'll get there also. I think, we have just listed the just simple settings of what is on a ventilator. Almost every setting is there, no? PA, PE, PWP, respiratory rate, PA, PE, flow. The only thing missing which I have not brought in is the FAO2, obviously. So this is a parameter which is adjusted mainly based upon saturation. So let's not get into this. That would have been discussed in some other lecture. How do we target oxygen saturations in a ventilator? So how do we do this? So all these optimizations of the various parameters. So how are we doing this in our day-to-day practice? Okay, so first is clinical, no? So whenever you put a baby on a ventilator, you may have some rough idea based upon your experience. Okay, this fellow is a 1 kg baby. Let me start with just some, let me not use pressures like 25 or more than 20. Let me start with something like say somewhere between 15 to 18 for PAP, and PWP may say somewhere, let me choose between 4 5, rarely 6. And that's one way. Or then we know the clinical teaching, no, classic teaching. So the PAP should be the one, the pressure which is good enough to just move the chest. The chest should not be moving too much. So just look for chest rise. If the chest rise is happening, if there is no chest rise, you increase the PAP. If the chest is moving a lot, you bring down the pressures. And PWP, you know, we go with chest retractions, right? So whenever a baby has got the retractions, especially the end inspiratory retractions and expiratory retractions, the baby keeps having retractions, that means looks like the FRC is not getting maintained. So we let people try to go up on the PWP. So the respiratory rate and TAT, mostly we don't play around with TA or TE. We have a set number, no? The magic number for TA is usually around somewhere around 0.35. And then we set a rate of somewhere between 40 to around 60, which is a normal respiratory zone of neonates. So PE will be automatically calculated once you set a respiratory rate. So that is one way, clinical way. Then, so how do we say, okay, whether to beyond, this is a very crude way. So the next is you will take an X-ray. And an X-ray definitely gives you a lot of clues. So an X-ray can tell you about whether the lungs are inflated properly, maybe fitting. Whenever an X-ray is overinflated, so hyperinflated film will tell you that you are using more pressures. An underinflated lung, low volume lung will tell you that maybe you are not using adequate pressures. So you can get some idea about the kind of pressures and volume what you are using in a chest X-ray, based upon a chest X-ray. Limited information only. So then what are the most important investigation we do in these babies to make changes to the ventilator to optimize ventilation? So we make use of saturation to certain extent. Okay, pulse ox will be there continuously. Whenever the saturation is consistently maintained well at a reasonably good amount of FiO2s, you may think about bringing down the pressures. And the blood gases to give you idea both about your oxygen levels and carbon dioxide levels, and to a certain extent, okay, the next is the pH. Okay, so CO2 we know is very much related to the volume. So we know these two, no? Oxygen has got a lot to do with pressures, what we call as the mean airway pressure, so which is influenced both by PAP and PWP, whereas the changes to carbon dioxide are more determined by the tidal volume or ultimately the minute ventilation. So we talk about whenever there is some, based on CO2, you make changes to the respiratory rate and the delta P. So that means the difference between PAP and PWP. Whereas based on oxygen, you make changes to PAP or PWP. Okay. These are all available right now. Then why do we need to? But what are the limitations of these existing methods? These are very, very good methods which we should be using actually. But the limitation of these methods is that, so we understand these are something like snapshots. None of these methods are dynamic. The changes that are happening in the baby are happening instantaneously. The moment you make a change to your PAP or a PWP, or the moment you bring in a different mode of ventilation, the moment you alter your PA and PE, the change is going to happen the same breath, no? It's happening in the baby. But you need to, the X-ray will come 4 or 6 hours later. And the blood gas, we don't have methods where we are doing a continuous gas monitoring in real time. That is also something like a snapshot. So they can give us some idea in which direction we need to proceed. Do we need to step up or step down? That much amount of information might be available. But if you are more interested in making changes to the ventilator in real time, so we need to understand what happens to the baby in real time. That's where our topic comes.
Ravi Kumar students.
Abhishek, are we good?
Yes, sir.
No issues, no? Yeah, okay. Okay, so this is some information that is being given by the changes that are happening, especially about the movement of air, about that is happening in and out of the lungs. We have a real-time measurement. Every breath to breath, if we can monitor what is happening to this. Okay, so that is so that we can quickly make changes. And if the change is something, and we can play around a lot for making, what to say, whether to continue with the change, or if the change is not working out, whether we can come down. The graphics have got, first and foremost, they help you to make real-time changes in all the ventilatory parameters, whenever you want to make a change in a ventilatory parameter. So, change in settings, whenever you want to make a change in a setting, ventilatory setting, so graphics are very, very handy. It doesn't stop there. So when I say a setting, that means it includes everything. Want to change a mode of ventilation, want to make a change to pressures, want to make a change to the timings what you are using. We'll discuss those in details. Next to first understand what is happening to the baby or the disease. So what kind of disease is this baby having? So we know grossly that diseases are of two kinds. No, you can have a problem in either in compliance, or you can have a problem in resistance. And it can be, what to say, either improving or worsening over a period of time. So how is this, these two basic parameters? To understand the current, what to say, pulmonary dynamics, lung dynamics of the given baby. How are they? Then, it might help you in many situations about planning or treatment or happen to this baby. You may have to decide whether I need to use bronchodilators in a given situation. Some you may need to think that whether I need to do an endotracheal right now. AT section, if there are very tube block. You may have to, sometimes it may guide you whether you need to put an intercostal drain. So lots and lots of planning your intervention. Okay, and I have given surfactant. Okay, I have given bronchodilators to this baby, I have given nebulization. Is it really working for this baby? Is it helping this baby? So to find the response to treatment, that's very, very crucial. And of course, it's also very handy in picking up certain acute complications of a baby, which are very difficult to pick up, which might take time, especially something like an air leak. So which we can pick up many problems in the pulmonary grounds. So there are many applications for is it okay at your end? Okay, I think let's move. So one very, very crucial factor that is very, very important before we start playing around about pulmonary graphics is to ensure you are having a good sensor in your ventilator. So if it is going to be garbage in, you know, garbage in always is going to be garbage out. Unless you have a reliable and a proven time-tested measuring the changes that are happening in the baby, that the feedback is the same. If you don't have a good sensor, so this is one piece of equipment with where we have to definitely, it's expensive. We need to invest in buying a good kind of sensor. And most importantly, it is a piece of equipment where maintenance is a big issue. So you might have bought a good sensor, but if your team and your people don't know how to maintain this sensor over a period of time, then so you cannot rely much upon the information what you get. And there are many people who say that, see, I do have facility for graphics, but it is not doing anything. I'm not getting the, I'm just learning so many things in lectures and from textbooks, but in reality, I don't see anything. So the biggest problem will be that you are not using the right kind of sensor, or your sensor is not working well. So just a few points. I think most of the things right now, the technology that is often used or preferred is in, you know, what is a hot wire anemometer. So this is is a kind of sensor which is widely preferred. It is also like a mnemotachograph, and this differential comes and all, the preferred more valid one, just prefer to go for a hot wire anemometer. The second one, always make sure your sensor is located proximally. That means, proximally means, what do you mean proximal? Close to baby. There are many machines which have a sensor which is lying within the machine, at this machine end. That is good from perspective that it won't get damaged soon because it's away from the baby, it's unlikely to get contaminated with secretions. So the life of the sensor will be good. That's why many equipment ventilator manufacturers prefer to just keep their sensors distally, that means close to the machine. But for you to make accurate measurements, so please prefer a proximally placed sensor and a good sensor like a heart rate. But I think enough of discussion. I think we have spent nearly half of the allotted time in trying to convince you why do we need graphics, and so optimization is the key, and what are the various situations in which graphics might come handy in taking care of a baby on a ventilator, and then the importance of having a good working sensor for you to play around with or get benefited from pulmonary graphics in a real time. Okay. So I'll try to draw some pictures here. Again, I have not brought in intentionally many pictures because you may get carried away with this stuff. So there are only two measurements now. What are the things that a sensor can measure? So whenever we put a sensor, what can it measure? The sensor can measure only a few things. It cannot measure everything. No? A sensor can, there are sensor, what is the itself, most of the sensors what we use are flow sensors. So it can assess in which direction the flow is happening during a breath. Is it moving towards the baby or is it moving away from the baby, and how much amount of movement is happening? And then when we divide flow over a period of time, obviously we get volume. Okay. And you can we know that we can measure pressure. The pressure changes what happened during inspiration and expiration. Of course, time is always measured. So in most of the situations, these three are the really measured ones in any sensor: flow, pressure, and the time. So the other parameters, whenever we talk about especially the values related to the volume or derived parameters, just we know, we can take the example of a blood gas machine, you know. So there are only a few parameters which are really measured, and many parameters output that comes out of a blood gas machines are derived parameters. Same way here, so a lot of importance, and the importance is given to flow and pressure, which are primarily measured parameters from a sensor, whereas something like in volume, whenever it gives values like your compliance of the lung, it will give values, so many values which will be displayed from your from the based upon primary measurements that are coming from this. Okay. So as these three are the primary ones which are we are interested in, especially the flow and the pressure. So the ventilator provides you certain graphs. So there are not many. We just have one. That should give a sense of release. We are not talking about the n number of graphs are here. We are just going to discuss and make use of. There are only simply 5 graphs available. Whenever we talk about pulmonary graphics, we are talking about only 5 graphs. Okay, it should not be difficult to just learn 5 graphs. No? Okay. So of these, I think they are of two kinds. So 3 are simple, which are called scalar graphics, and the rest of the 2 are called loops. Okay, only 5 graphs. 3 graphs are called scalar graphs. Scalar is very much easy. So what are the three primary parameters that we look into whenever we just say in anybody on a ventilator? Pressure, volume, and time. So the scalar graph is a simple representation where, say, I'm just putting a simple x versus y. Is in the scalar is going to put time in the x-axis. So what happens over a period of time? So then in the y-axis, I can put first. I can put pressure, which is one pressure versus time, which is one scalar graphic, and then you can put volume versus time. This is number two, and the third one is flow versus time. Simple parameters on the y-axis. So one of these pressure, volume, or flow. And always we do have time. First, discuss the scalar graphics and then we'll just move on to the loops. So there's one thing that you need to keep in your mind. Like pulmonary graphics in some way is something like an ECG. No? So how do you measure the ECG? Means we put a lot of electrodes around the heart. And then these electrodes are measuring the, or they just see what is the change that is happening in the action potential of the heart, which direction it is moving. But they're all sitting around the various regions, and then they're looking it from different, maybe leads region. You may say, okay, these leads correspond to anterior part of the heart. These leads are looking more at the posterior part, inferior part, and so on. But please understand, so wherever a lead is, that even if a lead which is sitting in an exactly opposite will also have a change. So you don't, one of the simple ways of eliminating one important finding always that I always use, it's very useful. Many a times you may get many artifacts in these pulmonary graphs. So to eliminate artifacts, we just follow what the cardiologists use in interpretation. So if you find a change, something is wrong somewhere, so it will be finding many waveforms in some way. Flow, you find a change in volume. What is a flow divided by the volume? What is the amount of flow happening over a particular period of time? That is what we mean by volume. There is hardly a situation, almost it doesn't exist, where you find the change happening in only one of these five graphs. If that is happening in only one and you don't find the change in the other corresponding graphs, it's like artifact, and then you have to be very careful. So just try to, so as you play on these parameters, it's a bit more comfortable. Just try to read any graph and you will be able to come out with lots and lots of information. We will be just discussing the predominant findings, or like from the, I can just put it like that. There are certain graphs which are easy to look at. You can just say this is a typical classical finding. If you find this graph okay, then it means that this is the diagnosis. That's fine. We are going to discuss those, that part. But realize that whatever we are saying will have some changes in the rest of the graphics as well. And it is good to learn those also and look for those things over a period of time as we learn these pulmonary graphics more and more. Okay. Let's start with simple, I think, pressure time. So we just the most simple and the common graph there in every ventilator. Sorry. Okay, as I said, so whenever we're talking about a pressure time scalar graph, we have time in the axis, pressure on the simple graph. So how will it look like? And we know that, well, let me just use a simple color coding, using red for inspiration, then I'll be using blue for expiration. So we know that, okay, the pressure is from, it starts from zero, let's say some number here up to 20, time runs in this direction. When on inspiration always starts with a PWP. The ventilator doesn't have, so you can't find a pressure graph. It's a simple way of identifying a pressure graph. A pressure graph always starts somewhere above where the PWP sits, right? Pressure, we are using always giving some pressure during expiration also. So what, what happens? So you start from PWP, then pressure builds up, reaches peak, stays at the peak for some time. This is during inspiration part. Starting from PWP, just there is a slope, slowly the pressure start building up, and then we reach a plateau. Then what happens during expiration? This gradually falls, then it reaches the PWP and stays at PWP. Then the next breath starts. So from here we just go, okay, and then your expiration. This is a simple pressure time scalar graphics. So we know what it is. We know where the peak is sitting. Okay, we know the line of the PWP, and we know where the this line corresponds to PAP here. Okay. Now, obviously, when you're calculating the time, what are the various things that we calculate from the point on? Abhishek, do you see a frequent flickering of the screen? Anyone, do you see any problem with the screen? Looks like it's flickering on my end. Are you getting it or?
No, the screen is not flickering, but there is just a beep sound that's on and off coming out from your microphone.
I'm not using microphone, but speaking maybe, I don't know. Okay, but
some on and off music is heard, but the screen is okay. Screen is perfect. Okay, voice is okay. No issues.
Okay. Fine. Thank you. So, and obviously we know that what is the time. So the time till this point. So this will be the inspiration time because the lung remains in inspiration. So the once the pressure starts falling, that is the time where we just see there is up to this PE. So starting beginning. We should be quite clear of the various components of the pressure. Just by looking at the pressure, what is the simple way to pick up a pressure graph? A pressure graph doesn't touch the baseline, number one point. So it always starts from peak. It will be sitting, it will be never touching the x-axis. It sits always above the x-axis. Because it starts from peak, moving to PIP, and then so nobody can mistake in whether this is a pressure graph. A volume graph can never be like that. A flow graph will also be never be. Every graph has its own typical characteristic. Without being labeled, even if nothing is labeled as pressure, you will know that this is a pressure graph. Okay. So let's just simply learn the other two and then we'll start move to interpretation. Second one, so let's look into simple volume. Okay. So how will the volume look up? What is the difference between a pressure graph and a volume graph? And we know that again, this is time, and this is we have volume here. Volume means whenever we are talking about a volume, we are talking only about tidal volume. We are not talking about the whole volume. What is about the changes that are happening? What do you mean by tidal volume? Amount of air that moves out of the lungs during every breath. That is only being measured by the sensor, no? We can't measure the function residual capacity or the various volumes that are sitting below those things. So the sensor measures only the tidal volume. So what happens to the tidal volume? During inspiration, the tidal volume keeps increasing up to a certain point. Then what happens during expiration? Some amount of volume went in inspiration, let's say 10 ml went in. So the red part is the 10 ml that we had went in. So maybe reach 10. The 10 has to come out, no? The 10 has to become zero. Become zero slowly, it comes out. This graph keeps on moving. You have smooth curve, which is running in this way. That's simple, no? Again, to identify, what is the difference between a pressure graph and the volume? The volume always just remember zero. This is not the case in a pressure graph. So we are talking only about tidal volume. It starts from zero, moves up to the tidal volume. So this topmost point, you know, is going to be the tidal volume. And usually it is symmetrical, inspiration and expiration. They don't have different phases. So it increases and decreases, increases, decreases. We can appreciate that the shape can be different based upon the kind of ventilation what we are using. We'll come to that later. In general, in a conventional ventilation where you are using a pressure-based kind of ventilation, which we all do most of the time, this is the shape of a volume, how it is going to be. Okay, fine. So what is the third one simply? Flow time. Okay, we have flow. Always x-axis is only time, then in y-axis we have flow. Is it okay to draw a flow time curve? I just intentionally, I thought I should draw first wrongly so that the people realize that this is not a way to draw a flow time. Why? Whenever we are drawing a curve, a scalar graphic, we are drawing the x-axis and the y-axis. It's the same, but what is wrong here? What is the difference mainly between a pressure volume and a flow curve? Builds up of 20, whatever you said, and then comes back. It remains in only one direction. Volume, it starts from zero, goes to some number like 10 ml, 12 ml, and then it comes back. But what about flow? The flow is the only one component which has got two directions. However, forget this. You can because the flow is moving in two directions. During inspiration, the flow is moving towards the patient. Then the flow stops. That means it is reaching zero. Whenever the flow stops, that is a zero. Then during expiration, it totally changes direction. It moves away from the baby. Okay, so that's why whenever we have to draw a flow curve, how do we draw a flow curve? We want both a positive as well as negative. Time always remains in the x-axis. X-axis, just one side is enough. We don't have any fluctuations in time. But whenever we are talking about flow, we need positive and negative. That means two directions. Flow moving towards the baby is considered positive, and okay, flow moving away from the baby can be considered negative. Okay, don't get confused between positive and negative. There are two different. So the flow starts gradually increasing. It goes flow. This is also still in. Is the main difference between pressure, volume and flow. In pressure and volume, this one loop is the whole respiration. Upward going is inspiration and the downward is in expiration in pressure and volume. What is here? The whole thing, because the flow increases, then the flow slowly decreases and becomes zero. Then the flow gets reversed. It has to move in the other direction, becomes something like this. Okay, so this is inspiration and this is has got two different directions. And this timing is an inspiratory time PI. And this timing, what we have is this time from here to here is the expiratory time. Sorry with me, we'll be able to simply understand these three graphs, no? So scalar graphs. Quickly, we'll move to the next one. We do have two loops. So what is the difference between a and the loops? So loops is something just simply playing around with these three parameters only. We have only three parameters, no? Pressure, volume and flow. First, what we try to do, we just tried plotting each of these parameters individually against time, what is happening over a period of time. That's what we did. But now we are just trying to go one step further. We are interested in, so what is the, we are just trying to compare the changes in one parameter happening in comparison to the other parameter at the same time. In simple terms, okay, if I'm increasing the pressure, what is happening to volume? If I'm decreasing the pressure, what is happening to volume? Maybe the other same way. Okay, if I'm increasing the flow, what is happening to volume? If I'm decreasing the flow, what is happening to volume? Things like that. So this is in real time. That means both are, the time is the same. So we are superimposing one over the other. So we are eliminating time. We are not plotting against same time frame. First thing is that, what is it? Well, let's take the first two components. There are only two. Okay. This is one loop, and then these two when you compare other loop. We are not comparing pressure with flow because volume is the one which is close to the flow. Okay, which can be interpreted. So first graph is very simple graph. No, we just discussed, no? Both these parameters, P and V, they are only in a positive direction. They don't have a negative direction. They don't have two different directions. So again, it will be a simple bit of you send an over. Rather than having time here, we are just going to put pressure on the x-axis and volume on the y-axis. So that in same time, whenever we make a change to pressure, we see what is happening to volume of the. So how will this graph be? Just in, what will happen to pressure during it? Just will draw the pressure part of it. Pressure will never start at zero, no? Always we need to start with PWP. We have to start something from here. We can't start, volume will start from zero, but the pressure will now will always start from a number, which is the PWP. Okay? We will start somewhere from here. Then the pressure gradually starts building up until it reaches a particular place. Then, so what is happening simultaneously to volume also? Okay, the volume will also keep increasing simultaneously, but from zero. Volume is, this is zero for volume. Volume starts from zero, pressure starts from PW. Then, okay, the reverse. Okay, so usually the pressure stays for some time. We know, no? In a pressure graph, how does it look like? The pressure will just go, reach, and then it stays here, no? This component. Just remember this plateau. There is, the pressure doesn't fall immediately. It stays there even after reaching, this is the PAP. Even after reaching PAP, it stays there for some time. Just the same reverse, you can just see the pressure doesn't fall very quickly. It will take some time for the pressure to fall. Then only the rapidly the pressure falls. Okay, the volume also gradually keeps coming. So this is the normal shape of a PV loop. Okay, there are certain, so you can just try to divide this into two components by drawing an arbitrary line in the center. So this is more related to the elastic component of the lung. So the inspiration part and this is more related to the resistive component. And this is more. Which is related to resistance and more related to elastance. These two are different. Just remember this much, we are plotting volume against pressure in real time. Okay, and then this is the graph what you get. What is the second one? Second, we said that we are going volume against flow. So again, whenever you are bringing volume against flow, we need to have two different directions simply. So it will be something like, again, you have to draw something like this. Okay. So which is the component which has to come in y-axis? Obviously flow. Why flow has to come in y-axis? Because people often get confused. Where is the, which is in x-axis and which is in y-axis? The simplest way to remember, flow is the one which has got two directions. Volume doesn't have two directions. Volume can only start from zero, go up and then come down. No? Volume has got only one direction. Only flow has got a positive direction and a negative direction. So simply flow has to be in your y-axis and volume is in x-axis. So the simple, what happens during inspiration, okay? So the volume just almost more like a volume curve. So taken the color for expression. Okay, this is inspiration. No, volume increases and then just volume, which is the flow also just increases. The flow happens in a return. Now volume. It has to come back. So, okay, something like this. So the red one is the inspiratory part here. Then and the, so what are the various components here which we can? So obviously this corresponds to the tidal volume. Tidal volume is sitting here. What is this bottom? Maximum. What called the peak inspiratory flow, we can measure this. And this is whatever is the maximal flow that is happening during expiration. We can estimate the peak expiratory flow. This is the peak expiratory flow. There will be some slow. Just the basic components what we can derive. Okay, so we have understood the basic components of these three scalar graphics and the two loops. It's just I will just quickly run through the various abnormalities what we can pick up from these various graphs. If you are very clear till this point, I don't think there will be any difficulty in picking up the rest of the anomalies, because I don't believe in starting with showing abnormal graphs and then trying to say, so look into this graph and see what is happening. The most important thing is understanding the basics, how it works. Now we can quickly go to what we can read and how we can read. Just give me 1 second, I'll call you back. Just give me a minute. Okay, sorry for making wait. Okay, we'll just take this approach. So what are the various parameters? We'll just what we are trying to do whenever we are reading pulmonary graphics. We try to find out whether we have these various parameters, the pressure I am using, and the timings what I am using, the flow I am using. So these are the parameters, and maybe the respiratory rate, obviously. These are the parameters what we set on a ventilator. So we are just simply going to find out whether this is okay, appropriate, or am I giving either excess of any of these, or is it sometimes it may be inadequate also. So straight away, let's start with first the pressures. So I'll take you to a graph where changes that do we need to look into. Whenever you want to think about flow, where you need to look into. Whenever you think about some complications, which graph will tell you more about simple complications. That approach, I think, will be very simple. So the pressure thing. So how do we mean? So what is the clinical approach that we use in general? Whenever we want to adjust PAP or PW, we will be looking for a chest expansion. What do you mean by chest expansion? So you are indirectly trying to assess what is the change in volume that is happening. You are just, okay, you are giving some pressure, but what is the change in volume that is happening? The chest is moving. If the chest is moving too much, that means the volume delivered is too much. Maybe you are generating unnecessarily or higher volumes. Again, okay, let's just look into the simply, which is the best graph to look into whenever you're talking about making changes about the PAP and PWP. You just simply go with our classical. Your PV loop, so pressure on the x-axis, because this is what we're always in clinically. So am I giving inadequate pressures or am I giving excess pressures? So this decision you always make only based upon the changes that are happening in volume. Pressure is always adjusted based on what happens to the volume. If it is bringing a good amount of increase in volume, if it is necessary, you need to do it. If pressure is not enough to give adequate volumes, you need to increase the pressure. If you are giving high pressures but it is not making big changes to the volume, then it is also useless. Unnecessarily, you may be giving higher pressures. That's not optimal. So how does this graph, you know, how it looks like? It starts from P, goes up, and then comes back and joins here. This is a normal PV loop, no?
Okay.
The first and foremost thing, so even before getting into the adjustment of PIP and PWP, we'll just finish. This is a very, very important, as this is the most common thing which we need to first understand in a baby, which is especially in acute ventilation, the first time a baby is being put on a ventilator. So we are most of the time we are dealing with diseases of compliance. even though there may be problems in resistance, we do have some diseases, meconium aspiration, BPD, air leaks, where problems can be more of a resistance. Most of our common diseases, TPN, pneumonia, RDS, all these are aspects of lung injury. Whatever you say, you name it. All these problems primarily are related to the lung compliance. Okay. So what is compliance? So we all know that the change, unit change in volume for a unit change in pressure. That is what we mean by, that is the definition of compliance, no? So I'm giving certain pressures. So what will be the change if I'm for a change of, if I'm making a change of 1 centimeters pressure difference, making a difference in pressure, how much ml of volume will change? That's what we call by compliance. So this gives a simple idea. We just keep things simply. So what do you mean by a simply, like this is the normally this will be something like around close to more or less close to 45 degrees in between this graph. Okay, this is the pulmonary graphic of a normal lung. Okay. So let's just now. Let's see your graph. How does it look like compared to the one what we drawn earlier? Or if you want to make it more, still I'll draw one more graph. So whenever we filter towards pressure, what is the simple understanding? So normally we had, so this is the tidal volume delivered. This amount, the maximum volume delivered here corresponds to the tidal volume. Now what is happening? For the same amount of pressure, you are getting only a less amount of tidal. The volume is decreased. Then whenever they get shifted to, it's more x-axis. So that means for higher amount of pressure, you are getting only a lesser amount of volume. You get less volume, but the pressure required is more. Obviously, the compliance is poor. If it moves towards it, the compliance is poor. So what is the reverse? If you're having a graph here in this direction, what does it mean? That means move towards the y-axis. So simply the reverse is true here, no? We are just talking about less pressures here. We need only less pressure to get this much amount of volume. So moving towards volume or the y-axis says the lungs are very, the compliance is improving. The curve which is becoming flat moving towards the pressure says that the lung compliance is poor. So most of your ventilators have got a facility where what happens is that what you need to do is that you can freeze the, for example, let's say you have an RDS baby. You just want to know what happens to the compliance, whether the compliance is really changing after giving a dose of surfactant. So that when there are options where if the initial curve is something like that, this will be there in the background. This curve will be stored as a reference curve in your machine. And then the real-time graph will keep on happening here. You will know what was it like some 2 hours, if this was 2 hours before and this is the present curve, as my compliance improve, is it improving over a period of time? So we'll be able to compare these things over a period of time. Okay. A simple another way quickly. All of you know about what is an C20 by C9, this ratio, use of this. It sound complex, but it is a very, very simple principle. Seeing better drop, sir. Okay. You have a curve. A compliance curve. Let's say this is the curve. Okay. So you just draw a line connecting these two points and just extend it. You just divide this into, this line is being divided into this is being divided into one first part, second part, third part, fourth part, things like that. Okay. So what is the slope of the line at the end, what is happening here, divided by the slope of this overall line. So that gives you an idea about what is the use of this one. If we are giving in a unnecessary high pressure, just you can look at only the shape of the curve simply. So how will it look like if you are giving higher PAP? How will it look like? What will happen if you are unnecessarily giving higher PAP? Up to certain points, the volume will keep on increasing. Then the volume doesn't increase anymore. It stops. The volume gets flattened. What is this called? Like a bird's beak, no? So we know that means what does beaking indicate actually? So beaking is, this is pressure, volume. Up to this point here, from here to here, you had almost a proportionate increase in volume happening. Whenever you're raising the pressure, the volume was also increasing. But what happens in the last segment? You keep on increasing the pressures further, but there is no increase, almost, there is very negligible increase in the volume. So this is an area where it clearly says that you are giving unnecessarily very high amounts of PAP. That excess PAP is not causing any significant change in the volume. And it need to come down under pressures. So typically the same C, what is maybe C20 by C dynamic? So this is the last part. If you take this alone, this is the 20th part, no? The slope of this one will be like this, and the slope of the other curve is going like this. So if you divide these two, if it's going to be less than 0.8, it has to always be more than 80%. It cannot move very much away. If the number falls to less than 80% of this slope, that means it says that, okay, this number is displayed in ventilators continuously. You can look into that number also, make use of it. So just understand what is this C20 by C. This is C dynamic, that means the complaints of the overall curve, and this is the 20th portion. Okay, so these things, how to identify the complaints, how to find the response to an intervention like a surfactant to pick up a change in complaints happening, to pick up excess PWP, what is beaking, we know now, this is the one we need to look for beaking. Okay, good, that says that we have to come down on the PAP. Okay. So anything else can we just learn from PAP? This is the most important part. What about PWP? So PWP, okay, we'll just, this graph can help this. Again, simply it can help in PWP. So whenever a graph, we are starting from here, find smoothly it should flow like this. But if you're just finding a graph somewhere like this, where it takes a long time, it stays here and then it moves up, comes down. This part, if this part is remaining very, very flat here. So what does it mean? So this pressure is called as the opening pressure of the lung. There are terminologies called lower inflection point and upper inflection point. I think I don't want to bore you with those terminologies. Simply understand, what does it mean? So till this point, you kept on, even if you're increasing the pressures, there is no increase in volume. Just like what is happening, just like the beaking, what is it? It's the reverse of beaking. The beaking is also here, no? The same like beaking, if that happens in the lower part of the complaints curve, if this remains very flat, that means for increase in pressure, if you don't find a good amount of increase in volume, that means you are not, your PEEP is not operating close to the opening. The PWP should be very close, just like this. What is happening in this curve? Okay, just quickly it starts increasing. We are already, the PWP is very close to the opening pressure. So we need to increase the PWP in this scenario, so that once you increase the PEEP, then if you move the PEEP from here to here, let's say this was 4 and this is 6, slowly if you're increasing it, then the graph will start going like this. So this flat portion will go. This is how we are PWP using ventilatory graphs. So
So quickly, we have discussed how to optimize PAP using this graph, PVA loop, and how to optimize the PWP using this graph, how to estimate compliance, and then the C20 bar C ratio. These are all open. Let's now quickly move to the other component. What is it? Optimizing the PI. Is not optimal. If you are operating with less PI, what will happen? Let's say that maybe actually requires for just at 0.4, you are giving only 0.2. What will happen? You can't within a maybe requires 0.4 for the inspirator tidal volume to move in. Even though we are giving the required pressure, if you are not giving enough time, obviously the pressure will not be completed. The delivery of the tidal volume is not going to be complete. So that is the problem. Less TA means that you are going to deliver only lesser tidal volumes and lesser minute ventilation. If how am I giving it more? Let's say I'm giving 0.5 for this baby. It requires only 0.4. What happens? So then that creates a situation. What is called it as? Anyone? We don't have an interaction option here. Okay, this is called, it will lead to a situation called inspiratory hold. What is inspiratory hold? I just need only 0.4 seconds for the air to move in, for the inspiration to happen. But if I'm keeping the TA at 0.5, what will happen? The air movement has happened. For the next 0.1 second, I can't expire also because the ventilator is still in inspiration. Maybe it cannot exhale, maybe it cannot move to expiration. So it is stuck in inspiration. If my ventilator will be inspiration, inspiration will not stop. That will be very uncomfortable for the baby. That's what we call as an inspiratory hold. So less TA will lead to poor delivery, poor gas delivery, poor tidal volumes, obviously. If the TA is much, if you don't have adequate TE, if you have a less TE, if enough time is not available, what will happen? Most importantly, that air cannot come out. It needs more time. Let's say again, let's use the same example. Let's say the required TA is something like 0.6, 0.4 is the required for inspiration. The TE is required is at least 0.6 minimum. If I'm giving only 0.5, what will happen? This will lead to the expiration cannot complete. This will lead to gas or air wrapping. Because we are not given enough time for the gas to properly move out. So gas gets trapped, some amount of gas gets trapped inside, air trapping happens. Whenever some amount of air is left inside, that air is going to create some pressure. So what this will lead to? What gas trapping will lead to? Auto peep or inadvertent peep. The right word should be inadvertent. This can lead to inadvertent peep. Unnecessarily, we will be giving some pressures which we don't want to give. If the gas which is remaining there got trapped there, we'll keep on giving some PWP. If you're adding the PWP again to that, we'll give high PWP, the risk of gas exchange will become less and you can land up with complications like that. So this is what we are interested in. Whenever we're talking about PA and TE, we want to pick up whether the tidal volume delivery is happening well, whether there is an inspiratory hold, or whether there is a gas trapping or inadvertent peak getting happen. I'll say one of the simplest graphs to give, because we are talking about TA and TE, you just take the flow graphic. You just take a scalar graphic. First, I'm just saying simply, most of these are well visible in a scalar rather than a loop. Talking about TA, go with the flow graphic. How will the flow look like? So this is a normal flow graph now. So how will be an inspiration normally? Here, expiration, this is, okay, TI, TE. What is good? In TI, all the gas has, in here the flow has come back to, this is here zero flow. The flow increased, the flow came back to zero at the end of inspiration. Then during expiration, the flow starts from zero, moves in the other direction, then the flow at both at the end of these two points, at the end of inspiration also the flow is zero, at the end of expiration also the flow is zero. This is the perfect graph. This is what we need to have if you are using the right TANT. Okay, so what happens if this gets altered, if you get a graph like this? Let's look into abnormal. What does it mean? What is happening here? What is wrong here? See, for understanding, we are just giving this color. The graphic, it won't be always color coded. The shape may be like this. You should be able to pick it up. So what has happened here? At this point, actually, expiration has started. The inspiration is only available up to here. So what does it mean here? So you need, normally, if this much component is getting missed out, this much amount of volume would have, this extra volume, this bit of volume we are actually losing here, because the TA is over and the ventilator has moved into expiration from this point on. So wherever you just see this, okay, I'll draw it again. Where the inspiration hangs somewhere, inspiration is not complete, the inspiration has not touched zero, and then suddenly from here the point it moves into expiration. So typically in a TI you have less TA. This is you, because this will lead to less tidal volume. If you look into the volume, actually the volume delivered for the same pressure, for example, let's say you are giving it a delta P of, let's say, around 12. Okay, the volume delivered with this TA is, let's say, 10 ml. For the same pressure, if you increase the TA, this may become 12 ml or 13 ml without doing anything, without touching the pressures, because the time is not available for it to deliver the proper amount of volume. So if inspiration stops here and the wave moves into expiration. This is inadequate TA. Reverse, what happens? What do you mean by an inspiratory hold? In a flow graph like this, where inspiration is like this, and then it stays for some time, nothing is happening, and expiration starts from here. It means you find a segment of the line where nothing is happening. Okay? Like the graph will be a continuous like this, it stops there, then it goes. Okay? What does it mean? So the inspiration is over here, the gas has moved out, but the baby is not, the ventilator is not moving into expiration. This is an inspiratory hold. So what should we be doing if we see a pulmonary graphic like this? Decrease the TI. Okay, simple terms, optimal TI like this. Everything touches zero. But the expiration flow is zero. No gap. Inspiration is over, then expiration starts. Okay? Inspiration stops well before, above. Before the flow touches zero, it stops somewhere above, it's hanging. Then expiration starts from there. What should we do? Increase the TA. You are not giving enough TA. This is inadequate TA. Okay. So it has reached zero, then it stays there flat for some time. Then there is some point somewhere where nothing is happening here. This means you are not having, you are have babies and inspiratory hold. This is a situation where you have to decrease the TA. Okay, let's move into quickly to TITE. T is related to the expiration. Normal graph, how it looks like. I'll draw you a graph. TE, we are hardly worried about. There is nothing like an excess TE. Okay, TA only can have less and more. TE is all, we set only the TA and the respiratory rate. Excess TE is not a problem. Gas has come out and it will be comfortably in expiration. No problem in excess TE, provided you are giving appropriate. The only problem is a short TE. That's why I listed, when I listed the problems, for TA I listed two problems, less TA and more TA. TE I have put only less TE. More TE is not a, clinically nothing really happens because of more TE, provided TA is okay. So how do we pick up whether TE is less? So if you see a graph like this where inspiration has happened like this, during expiration, the flow is not touching
zero, and then the next inspiration starts from here. So what has happened here? This is a zero flow, no? The inspiration, the flow has touched zero. During expiration, the flow has not touched zero. Just like just the hanging, what we discussed. Less TA means what? It is hanging. It is not touching zero and hanging somewhere. It is, if it is hanging in the positive component, like this is the hanging what we discussed. No, it has not touched zero hanging. That means TA is inadequate. The same thing is happening in the reverse. The hanging is happening the other direction. That means the expiratory part, it is still hanging. It has not touched zero. If you see the hanging here, this means inadequate TE. So this is what this leads to: air trapping. This will lead to inadvertent PWP, many problems. This is what we typically call as air trapping. So what we need to do, we need to increase the TE. This TE is not enough increase, so the grass becomes smooth till that it has to come and touch here. This is what we want. We don't want this portion to touch. I think we'll be very clear on how to adjust TE and TE. Okay. Okay. Let's quickly move to the other ones. Okay, what are the other things that we are doing? Flow. So how do we, as I said already, we are hardly nowadays play around with flow. But if you are playing, if you are having a ventilator where you have to set a flow, how do we decide whether the flow is adequate or not? If I'm just giving, especially when talking about, so whether it is an excessive flow or an inadequate flow. Simply, you just look into the pressure graph. This is the pressure graph, no? Normal pressure graph. So the slope of this is, let's say, what would be the kind of pressure graphs? Then this is a normal pressure graph where you have a slope of something like something close to 45 degrees. And then the graph looks nice and smooth here. So if the pressure graph looks something like this, the shape of the pressure curve is very important clue regarding flow. Whenever you want to assess the flow, you look into the shape of the pressure curve. If this is long time to reach peak, it stays and then it comes back into expiration. The other one could be the reverse. Just shoots, stops. Okay, this is the normal pressure curve, how it looks like. This is the slope where it is a smooth slope, it goes up, stays only for a short time. This is an ideal or an optimal flow for a pressure control ventilation. Okay, it should be like this. If it takes a long time, if the slope is very much moving towards the x-axis, it becomes flat. This kind of curve means that you are operating with less flow. You have to increase the flow. Still increase the flow to get a graph like this. This is a situation where you are unnecessarily giving higher flows. So that's why the pressure is just shooting up, just something like that. You don't want the pressure to shoot up something like that where within a short time it achieves this much amount of it. The curve has to be the curve. This, I don't want this excess. Okay, this is decrease the flow. So this curve, you have to increase the flow. If you see a curve like this in a pressure, so what is the simple word? Shape of the pressure curve, shape of the pressure time scalar graph gives you an idea about the flow. Whenever you're talking about flow, you want to adjust the flow, that is simple. Okay. Let me, you can have sometimes if inadequate flow can be, the same thing can get reflected in an PV loop. So you know how a PV loop looks like. If the PV loop, normally a PV loop is somewhat like this, no? Sorry, I'm using the wrong. If the loop is very, very narrow, very, you just see a very narrow loop, again, there is a possibility that means the flow is decreased. Narrow loop, it gets compressed in this direction. It's compressed. If it is, the curve looks very narrow. Okay, the curve doesn't look the right size. That means, okay, it looks. Now, what is happening to the. It means the flow is not adequate. This implies the flow is less, and what you need to do is that you need to.
sometimes you may find, or maybe this galloping happening. During inspiration, this is because of what we call as an air hunger. The baby doesn't get enough flow from the machine during inspiration. So the baby starts taking, this is the area where the baby starts taking its own breath, because the flow is not enough, it's not supporting. This is air hunger. This shows again that flow is inadequate. If you have a shape like this, you need to increase the flow. Okay, fine. I think we can last small thing, we can move to the last graph, that flow volume. Flow volume is all about simply mainly to pick up these two things which are very commonly happening: air leak and air trapping. We have discussed air trapping already in the flow curve. So flow curve is good enough to diagnose air trapping. That's a very good curve, flow time scalar. But this you can use of this also. But air leak is something which is visible. Leak has got something to. Just remember these two points. Whenever we talk about, if you remember this, then you won't make any mistake. Air leak has got something to do with volume. What do you mean by air leak? I'm giving some volume. So some amount of the tidal volume which went in is leaking somewhere. It is not coming back. So the volume that is coming out will be definitely less. When it goes in, say it is 10 ml, only 8 ml is coming out. 2 ml is getting leaked out. So less volume coming out. That is air leak. So you will appreciate the changes in the volume graph, or the volume component of the flow volume loop. Whenever you're talking about air trapping, what does it mean? Air trapping has got more to do with the flow. This is all related to the flow. The word trapping itself says it is related to flow. So air is not flowing either out. Air is flowing out during expiration. It is getting trapped inside. So trapping will be well made out in either a flow time scalar or else the flow component of the flow volume loop. Let's just look into how it will look like at each signal. I'm just drawing a flow volume loop. You know how a normal loop looks like. This is inspiration. This is expiration, smooth. Everything zero, zero, zero. So this is volume. This is flow. Flow also touches zero. Volume also touches zero at the end of inspiration and expiration. Okay. So now we are just drawing abnormal graphs. Easy to pick up. Inspiration happening like this. Stops here. What is it? Just look into something has not touched zero. Which has not touched zero? That's what you need to look into. This is volume, right? Because volume doesn't have a negative component. X-axis volume. Flow is the one which is there in the y-axis, which has a positive or negative thing. This much amount of what, say 10 ml volume has gone in, and only up to say this is let's say this is 3 ml. How do I keep getting this flickering? Yeah, let's say this is 3 ml. What does it mean? Of the 10 ml that has went in, only 7 ml has returned. This 3 ml is lost somewhere. So the volume has not touched zero. Whenever the volume has not touched zero, what does it mean? This is air leak. The leak could be pneumothorax, the leak could be around the endotracheal tube. Many, many things can be there. Okay, this is air leak. So how will it, simply how can you confirm in the other graphs? You can confirm this air leak in the other graphs as well. If you look into the volume graph, how will it look like? Volume will go up, it will stop here, it won't touch zero. Because this is the leak component, air leak. This will be the volume graph finding of an air leak. Okay, even if you look into a PV loop, you can find it in PV loop. As I said, the changes will be there everywhere. In PV loop, how will it look like? It will go up like this, and then the volume stops with here. That's all. That means that it stops here. It doesn't come and touch this. The curve stops here because the volume is not coming back to, this is the zero for volume. You find a gap here in this region in the PV loop. If the PV loop is like this, this is, says there is an air leak. Volume graph, if this says this is an air leak, here in the flow volume loop, this is, these three are all indicating the same thing, that there is an air leak happening. Always compare and just confirm that this is happening. So we'll quickly move to air trapping. The reverse. positive flow. What is not touching the zero here? This is flow. Flow is not touching zero. This is zero flow. Inspiration flow touches zero, expiration flow is not touching. This is typical, volume has become zero. Okay. Whenever the flow this is air clapping. So you can just see the same in the scalar graphic of the flow. It means how will it happen? Sorry, scalar graphic will be not like this. The expiratory flow will not be touching zero. It stays here, this gap. These two are the same. You can either find in the flow time a simple scalar graphic or in the flow volume loop. Whenever the flow is not touching zero, that means it is aircraft. Okay. That's a simple thing like what you can find secretions, you can find whenever sign a baby with BPD, I think you know what happens, how do you diagnose resistance, the problems sometimes whenever you're dealing with babies with BPDs, how will be the graph like? So let's say this is a normal graph, it has to look like this and then it has to come back. Let's say this was the graph to start with. As time goes up, I'll just draw on the other side. As the baby's resistance becomes more and more, what happens is that this peak inspiratory flow and peak expiratory flow, because of the high resistance, this starts falling. This becomes slow. The number comes down. And the expiration also, it becomes slow and takes a long time also. Yeah. This number becomes slow. This becomes short. So this is the typically we say that compared to this graph, the baby's resistance is getting worsened, and that's why both peak inspiratory rate as well as peak expiratory flow are coming down, and it is taking a long time. If you look into the flow graph, this is the typical flow graph. Is again a very good graph to pick up resistance. So normal graph in a flow graph, positive, negative. This is a normal graph. What happens in BPD or other situations where the resistance goes up? The airway, this also small. Most importantly, this becomes small and this keeps on taking a long time. Something goes up, something like this. This is the typical pattern of an increased airway resistance, the very fall in peak expiratory flow, and it will obviously lead to some amount of air trapping ultimately. You can use bronchodilators, you can appreciate bronchodilators once we start doing it. In secretions, it's easy to identify whenever things are positive, whenever you find lot of changes happening here. No? If it is not okay, that means that the tube has got either water, predominantly endotracheal secretions, can just suck out the secretions from it. There are some nuances which we do have in addition to, these are the typical conventional graphs, what we need to know, everyone has to be aware. If you know, I have discussed how to optimize PAP, how to optimize PWP, how to optimize the flow, how do you operate upon TA. TA has got two things, how to pick up an inadequate TA and how to pick up an excess TA. Inadequate TA leading to less tidal volume delivery, excess TA leading to your inspiratory hold. As far as TE is concerned, we are more worried about an inadequate expiratory time. Excess expiratory time is not a problem. If the TE is inadequate, it will lead to air trapping and then it will lead to an auto peak or an inadvertent peak. We have discussed that. We have discussed how to look for whether flow is adequate. The primary look for shape of the pressure curve, whether it is normal. Very quick rise in pressure curve, that means flow is high. That's taking a long time for the pressure to build up. It's a slow, the very, very long slope. It means the flow is not adequate. Whenever in a PV loop, if it looks very narrow, or the baby has got air hunger, if it sucks in air, if it is looking for air hunger, that it sees that flow is inadequate, increase the flow. And we know that whenever the word air leak comes, think of volume. Leak leads to volume. Okay. More in the volume, but zero in the flow volume loop. Whenever you use the word air trapping, that has got to do with flow. Flows will not touch zero in a flow time graphic, as well as the same, you will find the flow not touching zero in a flow volume loop. resistance you can better judge by the flow curve, peak expiratory flows, and the shape of the grow leading to air trapping. Secretions you can easily pick up, air leaks you can easily pick up. Thank you so much for such a patient listening and the extra time that has been given to me. I think I have exceeded the limit by more than 30 minutes. If people still have some stamina to ask a few questions, I'll be happy to take it. Thank you. Thanks for the opportunity.